hear me? Yeah, great. Okay, so my name is Daniel Rudmark. I have two employers. One is Viktoria, Swedish ICT. It's a research institute in Gothenburg where we work with applied IT research with the transportation and vehicle industry. I'm also doing a PhD thesis on how organization approached unpaid developers and how they can design their API platform so that they can attract this, this resource. And prior to doing this quite narrow subject, I have a tech background from the industry, being a developer and architect and so forth. And the title of my presentation is Why Unpaid Developers Use APIs and What You Can Do About It. And I hope that you can take some things away from this presentation as well. So, for the last 5 years, since 2009, I've been working a lot with the public transport industry in Sweden, and they have undergone, quite dramatic transformation in that today, a lot of the information that travelers interact with comes from third-party applications. And that was not the case, perhaps, when I started with this. So those third-party applications, they are business critical. And a lot of the traffic is coming from third-party developers. And I think that some of you who came here were probably using some of those applications as well. I've been using different methods. I've been interviewing. I think I actually hit the 50 spot now, more than I've been interviewing 50 developers. I've been interviewing them about why they do it. I've been doing it as a part of evaluation of APIs. What do you think about them? What are their experiences? What are their frustrations? Or so forth. And also doing something called action design research, where you actually take the knowledge that is existing about third-party developers and you try to design the API platforms so that it will fit sort of the target group that you try to reach. And this is some of the projects I've been working with, and I will be mentioning some of those during this presentation. Okay, so I think that one of the things that usually we bring up when we have workshops with research partners is that typically when you think about software development, it's something that you pay upfront. You pay them by the hour or by the project. But in third-party developers, in third-party development, they come to you. So that means that if they don't get something out of it, they won't really come to you, right? So we were thinking about, okay, so what are the motivations? Why are people engaging in third-party development? And we were looking at the literature, and we can see that there are sort of two strands of motivation. One is extrinsic motivation, that is something that comes from the outside. And then you have intrinsic motivation, that is something that comes from within. If you look at intrinsic motivations, that can be, of course, money. Money is a very good motivator. It can make people do good things and bad things. We have user groups. Or user needs. For instance, we have seen how there have been niche services for people with cognitive disabilities, for instance. Signaling, maybe you want to show that, look, I'm a really good iPhone developer, so I did this service, I put it out on the App Store, and then people might hire me as an iPhone consultant, for instance. That's something we've seen. Then we move towards the more intrinsic motivation. We have things like status. Say that I'm an Android developer and I want to hire my status in the Android community, so I might do a service because of that. We have reciprocity, that is when you feel that there is an engagement from the platform owner. So maybe that they respond to your questions, that they will recognize you as a good developer and so forth. That's sort of in the border between extrinsic and intrinsic. And then we have the more intrinsic ones, and I think those is the one I will perhaps talk mostly about in this talk. We have fun or flow. I think that most of you are aware of the flow concept, where you hit the right competence level and you can just go on for hours and hours and you don't really, you lose track of time. Autonomy. Most developers, they have a daytime job where they're told what to do. They have bosses, they have clients. So they have these hobby projects where they can decide what they do. And that's something that causes the motivation to continue. problem solving, I think this is the most salient motivator that we've seen, is that it's the combination of commuter and programmer. And their experience with public transport information has been a bad one, and think, I can do something better. And so they did, and they put it out on the App Store, and some of them have now hundreds of thousands of users. Then we have professional and personal identity. I am an iPhone developer, and by developing iPhone apps, I strengthen that identity. And learning. This is something we saw when we had the Windows Phone came out. People wanted to learn Windows Phone to develop stuff. And some of those projects who started as learning projects has actually moved into apps that people are using on a daily basis, lots of them. And what we saw when we analyzed these services was that these things are hard to make money out of because they're pretty simple and it's something that people don't have a tendency to pay for. So the motivation that we found was much on the intrinsic side. So we were thinking that, okay, so people are doing this for intrinsic reasons. Where can we look to find support so that they will keep this intrinsic motivation, so that we don't scare them off, so that they find the APIs attractive and that they still want to work with them? And there is actually a well-accepted theory of human motivation called self-determination theory. This is something that was discovered in the 70s by two American psychology professors. And this is a widely accepted, and this has been empirically tested over and over again in many different contexts. So it has been used in education, in healthcare, in work motivation, and so forth. And what is interesting about this is that it doesn't really explain why people would build a public transport app, but it would explain what would sustain that motivation and what would facilitate it and what might stop it to grow out or to hinder it. And what they found is that there are two specific concepts that are involved, and that these two concepts have a direct effect on your intrinsic motivation. So the first one is autonomy. And autonomy, like it says here, is the universal urge to be causal agents of one's own life. So I'm calling the shots. It's not some other person in the outside, it's me. And you need to be that you are in control of your behaviors and your actions, and that this has been shown in a myriad of experiments that outside control will decrease motivation. So this is a psychological sort of finding. So this is the first one. The second one is the feeling of being competent, that you control the outcome and that you master whatever you're doing. And another thing that has been shown that is that if you are being fed with feedback on that you are competent, this will increase your motivation. And if you will get feedback on that you're not competent, your motivation will decrease. And then, of course, different people have different degrees of competence, and I will show you later how this might play out in an API scenario. So this was sort of a little background. And now I will show you how this have played out in some of the things that I've studied over the years. So let's talk about autonomy and license terms. Okay, so, I mean, an API specifies what is possible to do, and the license term specified what you're allowed to do, right? So we were doing a case study on Stockholm public transport. Actually, Elias was a part of this as well. Yeah, where we were looking at, I think that today and for the last few years, they've been very good at interacting with developers, but they also have a history of not being so successful. So for 2 years, they were running a third-party developer program that didn't get the leverage that they were looking for. So for 2 years, they had 27 contracts signed for that. And this program, for instance, the service was supposed to be pre-approved before entering the market, sort of like iPhone is doing or the iOS scheme. And there was a lot of other things as well. And then they launched Traffic Lab, which is currently available where anyone could access and much less restrictive license terms. And when we tried to understand, I mean, why is this different? This is, of course, something that if you're a researcher, you want to understand why this happened. And we collected data on this, and I think this quote is a pretty good illustration. It's not the only explanation, but I think it's a big part of it. And he said that he came up and he was about to sign this contract, and he said that you were not allowed to store data on your phone, and you had to use pictures in a certain way, and that was just a lot of restrictions. And it prevented me from doing stuff that I wanted to do. He was no longer calling the shots. It was the company who was. So his autonomy was cut off in a way. So I think that's a major part of it. And now I want to, because license terms are difficult, I think that anyone who tried to do it realized that. So I want to just give a quick pointer to this. This is a project called the Swedish API license that I've been doing together with Andreas and Elias and a law firm, where we were trying to reconcile, because of course companies need to protect their resources. And then you have developers wanting autonomy. So there's a struggle between those two things. And we've been trying to reconcile that and also been able to tailor your, depending on your situation. And also you have legal, of course, you must be legally compliant. So we also have a lawyer in this project who has been making sure that the license term is legally compliant. So just if you are interested, you can look at that. Okay, now I'm going over to feelings of competence, as I told you earlier, and REST endpoints. And this is the good side of REST endpoints and feelings of competence. In 2012, again, me, Andreas and Elias, we had a project together with the National Transport Administration where they were trying to understand this group of unpaid developers, you could say. I mean, they have always been open to third-party development, but they were used to working with guys like Google, TomTom, Garmin, and these types of applications that people were using, apps, they have been widely successful. People were using them, but they didn't really know how to approach this developer community in a way. So we had a project for that in order to launch some sort of APIs as a result. So this was the process. I will not go through it in detail. But one of the things that we found was that a lot of people who were doing apps and web pages that people were using, they were not so interested in learning about the domain, about train data and so forth. And the interfaces that the National Transport Administration had at that time, for instance, for road accidents, they had that. It was a big complex standard called DATEX, and that's great if you want to move your service from Sweden to Denmark to Britain to Spain, if you're a company, because they all implement this standard. But it has a high threshold, learning threshold. It takes a couple of weeks to learn it and to do something exciting with it. And when we interviewed the developers, they said, no, we don't want to spend 3 weeks learning a standard. We want to solve our problems, and we want to solve them as quickly as possible, right? So we did this API, and I'm sorry for the resolution here. It didn't come out very well on this screen, but I'll try to explain it. So this is a REST endpoint, a REST API. This is pretty simple. Up here, if you read from the right, you can see it's the arrivals to Lindome station in Western Sweden. So that means that this is pretty easy for anyone to get started with. You don't need to know much about trains. Here, it's coming from Kungsbacka and it's going to Gothenburg. The first one here was the planned time of arrival. It was 7 minutes to 11, and it actually came 1 minute early, this one. It was a very special train. And then you can see here, it's a platform, what platform you're going to take that train. So this API, even I can understand, even though I haven't developed for a few years, which means that you don't need a lot of domain knowledge. So then I made a rounds of interview after this, trying to evaluate, was this API working or not? And I was getting in touch with different people. I think this is an interesting example. This is Nässjö in Sweden. It's a small town, but it's a railway crossing. So people change trains in Nässjö. This means that people spend a lot of time in the train station, maybe 1.5, 2 hours, because they're afraid if they will move out in the town that they may miss the train, right? And the people who have shops in Nässjö, they want people to go and shop instead, right? So this guy who was this general IT guy was working for the municipality and the shop owners. He was doing mail administration and Windows installation and so forth. He could do a little hacking as well. He found this API. And he said that, oh, I felt like I was really competent. He wasn't using those words, but I mean, that was the feeling he was conveying, in a sense. And I think that was because this was very easy. He didn't have to learn a standard, because he wouldn't have spent 3 weeks learning the standard. But, okay, 3 weeks, 3 minutes. Okay. But there was also something bad with this, and that was that this limited APIs, you can do this, list stations by name or position, list departures and arrivals, and get a specific train. But then this question started to come up. I want to list all train departing from Uppsala to Stockholm. I want to monitor if a certain train is late. This was not very easy with this API, right? So instead, we said that, okay, we should give developers more autonomy. Now, they couldn't do what they want to do. Their autonomy was, this REST API hindered their autonomy. So what we did was, now it's going to be a pedagogical challenge to explain this, but in a short time. But this was, they had already a query interface that they were using internally, which has a lot of flexibility. But as you can see, this is not as easy as the REST APIs we were doing. This requires that you know what you're doing. But they said, let's give this to developers instead. And the experienced developers, they said, yeah, sure, it works great. This guy had tried pretty much any public transport API that is out there, and he really liked it. This was one example. But then again, we might lose the ones that are not as experienced as this guy. So what did we do there? So instead, here, We took the same use cases as we were displaying as REST endpoints, made them as examples, linking them easily to an API console, so that they really didn't have to understand exactly what the code did, but they could use it anyway. And this was, of course, I was a little bit skeptical and a bit afraid that this wouldn't work for the less experienced, less competent. But we did usability testing on this, and it actually turned out pretty well. So that was good. Final takeaways. Okay, so if your third-party developers, do they rely solely on a business case and making money? If they are not doing it purely out of business reason, they have some other reasons. And it's very likely to be an intrinsic reason. And then you have to make sure that they experience autonomy and feelings of competence. Because if you do that, you're more likely to sustain that intrinsic motivation. And that also means that you must initiate third-party developer feedback loops, because these things will not come to you in your email box. You have to actually go out and find it with the developers. So that's my presentation.